this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and we're here on location outside Orlando, Florida, in Howie of the Hills, and that's about 45 minutes outside Orlando. So if you guys live in the Orlando area, or if you're just even in, like, I drove here from Tampa last time, you want to definitely come to this place, A Natural Farm. I've known the owner, the farmer here, for the last 5 years. Link down below the original video I made here at A Natural Farm. They have fruit trees, edible plants. They're non-GMO. They give classes and tours. They're a chemical-free farm. And more importantly, they ship to you, right? They could ship you plants because they're fully certified to ship all over the United States. Of course, they don't use any pesticides, no chemicals, and they're non-GMO. Check them out at anaturalfarm.com. Today's episode is specifically because a lot of you guys have asked me, John, I live in Georgia, man. I want to grow avocados. I love avocados, and I hate when I got to buy them from Mexico and they're imported. And in the wintertime, a lot of avocados are imported, and the taste sucks, man. I grew up in California where we get really good avocados, but I know a lot of you guys love avocados, and the reason why I'm here today is to show you guys the best varieties that can even withstand freezing and still be alive and still produce avocados. They just don't talk the talk here, they walk the talk, because literally they have an avocado orchard in the backyard that they use to propagate the trees that they end up growing out and then selling to you. Plus they've seen how the plants grow over the years and at what temperature the plants get damaged at, so that you don't buy that kind. And you know, they could say the most cold tolerant avocado, so that you'll have the highest probability to get fruit. Of course, that being said, there are no guarantees in life, and if you do get an avocado and you live in a climate that's not tropical or even subtropical, you will need to do extra work to protect it. Not planted in clay soil, so the soil drains really well and it's not gonna freeze out by protecting it in the wintertime. Here's the thing I want you guys to know about A Natural Farm here, you know, outside Orlando. You know, number one, they do a lot of educational work where they actually, the master farmer here will share with you guys for free his knowledge and tips, so that you guys could learn how to do things like grafting and how to, you know, propagate different plants, right? So the first thing you guys want to do, especially if you guys live anywhere within like 2 hours of this place, 3 hours even, I would drive 3 hours to come here for sure. I mean, I'm on a 24-hour layover, guys. Like, literally, I flew into Orlando last night at like midnight, I fly out tonight at 10, and this is the place I come to share with you guys, because it is that important, right? So get on their email list. They give free classes. You would be stupid if you didn't come to their free classes. The last free class, man, they had like 120 people. Last time I was here, they didn't even have this big barn and educational center that they have now, and that's why I really love and value them. Now, even more so than just the free education work they do, what they do here is even more important, because actually they grow stuff on the property. This is a farm, not just a nursery. What you guys don't understand is most nurseries you're gonna go to, they just basically buy plants from some plant wholesaler, the nursery guy, and then resell it to you, and they don't have actually experience growing the stuff. They'll say, oh yeah, it's frost tolerant because they just read the tag, but they don't know for sure in their real heads because they haven't grown it. And that's what I really love about the farmer here, Luke. He basically has this food for us. He shows what you guys could do, and actually some of the plants in this food forest he takes cuttings from. He basically, you know, propagates them, and the plants you buy are literally born here in Florida. And a lot of the plants that may be sold in Florida may be shipped from outside the state, you know, coming in from Georgia and other states. And then, you know, hey, how is a plant in Georgia gonna really thrive in Florida, right? If a plant's gonna thrive in Florida, it should be tested in Florida, grown in Florida, so that you guys know you're gonna get a good plant. So that's why I would come here to drive, because you guys know that you're gonna get plants that will produce, because he's tested them out in the food forest. So in any case, now let's go ahead into the avocado grove area where he's testing and has been growing avocados there at least for 5 years, because they were here last visit, probably for longer, and share with you guys his knowledge bombs on avocados and which ones you want to buy, so that you guys could have fruit in the off season, so that you guys could have fruit when it's too cold and maybe you live in a climate where they aren't optimal to grow avocados. You could get the tree that gives you the highest probability of success. So yeah, let's head down to the avocado area. So now we're here with Luke, who literally started this farm 10 years ago. These avocados are about 10 years old that you guys are looking at. And you know, when he started, you know, he was like literally not even a hole in the wall, because there was no hole, there was no wall. This was just barren, empty land that now he's turned into a productive nursery as well as many plants in the ground. The other thing I want to let you guys know that this is a family business, and that is my dream. Him and his wife work together. Luke is more into the, you know, the fruit trees and the fruit side. And if you want to know about the vegetables, which I'll have another video on, hopefully, you don't want to talk to the wife because she's more in the vegetable stuff and he's more in the fruit stuff. And one day I hope to find a nice wife, girlfriend, partner who we could specialize in different parts of growing stuff together. And that's like my dream. So that's like really cool. I like appreciate him so much. So Luke, tell us about growing avocados. Not only here in Orlando, but I know you've shipped these avocado trees around the whole country.
Yep.
You know, if somebody wants to grow avocados and they live in Georgia, would you say that's possible or impossible or difficult or what?
Yes. So thanks again for coming, John. So yes, it's possible to grow avocados in places where you most likely would not expect. The key is to try to buy not the smallest tree. Buy a tree that would be about 5 feet tall. If you buy a small tree, babysit it for about a year, where it can get a thicker trunk and be more cold hardy. But yeah, we ship avocado trees and other fruit trees, olive and all the fruit trees all over the states. And as far as the varieties that John will look at with us, is we have about 10 main varieties that we use here in Central Florida, and some are hardy down to about 15, 18 degrees. When they are mature trees.
So tell us about the hardiness. Does that mean like it's hardy down to 18, I planted it and there's snow on the ground for 2 months, is it still going to be alive if there's snow on the ground? But it's hardy to 18 and it only got down to 20, but it's for an extended season of 20.
Yeah. So the key with avocados is the drainage in the soil. So if it's 20 degrees and you have a wet soil, then you may lose your tree. If it's 20 degrees or 18 degrees and you have sandy soil like here, or your soil will drain properly, then your tree will be stronger. So that's why the temperature is not the only key factor. It's the drainage of the soil and also the wind. So you want to make sure if you're in a northern place like Georgia or South Carolina, that you create a windbreak for your trees so that the wind chill is not as bad as if it was in the middle of a field.
Right, so windbreaks could be as simple as maybe like putting up some 2x4s around the tree and then basically making kind of a wrap around it so it's breathable, not totally enclosed, or maybe, you know, planting some trees that basically break the wind so the wind doesn't hit the avocado directly but then hits these trees on the other side to prevent it, right?
Yeah. So for us, the key is to break the northern wind. So north, maybe northwest, and you can use some kind of material, a breathing material, or if you don't use breathing material, just to make sure that material does not touch the leaves. So you create a teepee around your tree, and you could use a plastic, but make sure that plastic does not touch the tree. And in the morning, after the cold, make sure you remove that plastic so that you're not baking your tree. You could also use a windbreak, like a wall. You plant your tree on the south side of your house or a barn, or you create a windbreak with plants like yerba mate or podocarpus, any kind of evergreen shrub, large shrub that will make that windbreak.
So what are some other tips to keep the avocado alive in the winter? Because it will lose all its leaves in the winter, of course, but how do you know if it's still alive after it comes out of the winter, if you protected it or?
Right, so when your tree gets damaged by the cold, being an avocado or a mango, do not trim it back. Even if you see a lot of damage, do not trim the tree back until about early April. Because what's going to happen is, very often, if even you lose all the leaves, if you still have some green wood, then your tree will create new leaves in the spring on the trunk, and then your tree will grow back into a mature tree or a bigger tree really quickly in the summer.
Yeah, I've saw that myself because I planted like a Mexicola variety in my house in Northern California. And all the leaves dropped and I was like, this is dead. And I just left it. And like even the top part where it died was just all like literally rotten. And then just, I didn't cut it because I knew that it might come back. And then right down below that, it just started sprouting up new growth. So yeah, there's always a possibility. And of course you could call them here and they can help you, you know, with more tips. but I want to get into this video to share with you guys the best varieties you guys want to grow. As you guys can see, there's about 10 varieties we got to go over, so we got to talk pretty quick. So
yep.
The first variety we got is the Joey, and so tell us about the Joey avocado and why somebody may or may not want to get this particular yes. cultivar.
So Joey is very cold hardy, one of our cold hardiest varieties. The only drawback of the Joey is it's a tiny fruit, so it's kind of a Mexican type fruit, but it's a small fruit, and usually when it ripens in the summer, we eat it like an apple. So you pick it from the tree, because it doesn't really ripen on the tree, you let it ripen in your house for a couple of weeks, and when it's super soft, then you eat it with the skin like an apple.
Yeah, I love the edible skin avocados for sure. And then what's the cold hardiness of this?
That variety is hardy down to 15, 18 degrees when it's mature. So when it's about 6 to 8 feet tall.
So once again, you know, when you get a little baby right now, you must protect it, nurse it, make sure it's, you know, up to 6, 8 feet tall and it has thick wood. Then that's when the cold hardiness, you know, comes into play, not when it's, you know, still very young.
Yes.
Wonderful, let's go ahead and check out the next one. All right, so the next tree we're at is the Lila, and you can see this actually has a little bit more lighter green leaves. What's going on here, Luke?
Yeah, so this is Lila or Lila. It's a very compact tree. Some people call it a semi-dwarf variety. Also very cold hardy, down to 15, 18 degrees. And the fruits are, those are make a green fruit, but they are the similar texture and flavor than the has. So it's almost like a little bale-shaped fruit. Very cold hardy.
So is it like more watery? Because I know when I come to Florida, a lot of the avocados I eat are just more watery style. They're not like the buttery hot that I get in California.
Well, actually, those 10 varieties we're looking at today are all more like a Mexican type with a buttery texture, flavor, just like the hot. So we do not really sell the typical Florida watery variety. Most people do not like that variety here in Central Florida.
Yeah, and I see a lot of, you know, normally places sell those trees, not the good ones that you have here.
Yeah, yeah, you have to be very careful when you buy a tree that you get the right proper variety.
Wonderful, and do you ever have like an avocado tasting? You know, if somebody is here and they happen to be fruiting, or you have them?
Yeah, yeah, so another thing we do here, besides providing mostly free classes and people can text me, email, is we do not sell fruits, so we let people try the fruits. We could have 100 fruits on an avocado tree, and we'll give them away to children or to customers. And when you come here and they are ripe, then we'll let you test the fruits, or the avocado or the mango or any other fruit here.
Wow, another good reason to visit the A Natural Farm here in Florida. All right, so now we're at the Winter Mexican avocado. So tell us about this one. I love the Mexican style avocados myself. They're my favorite.
Yes, Winter Mexican is pretty much the most favorite variety for Central Florida, all the way from Tampa or south, all the way up to the Ocala area. Winter Mexican, the beauty of this variety is that it does not ripen on the tree, so you can harvest fruits from November until March.
Wow.
So if you have 150 fruits like we did last year on this tree, you could technically eat fruits from November until March, because the tree will have the fruits hanging, and you just pick a few every day and let them ripen in your kitchen, and the fruits will stay on the tree for that long. Really good, same texture, flavor as the has.
Wow, and then can you eat the skin on this one?
I've never tried the skin. I would not be surprised that you can eat the skin.
Is it a thin skin or more like a has?
It's more like the has type skin.
Probably not so much. Yeah, you want the thin skin for the edible.
Yep, and normally. Then very cold hardy as well.
What's
the temperature? Probably about 26 degrees.
Oh, wow, 26.
Yeah, last year, all these trees, we had 26 degrees, and I don't think we lost more than 10 or 20 leaves per tree.
Ah, so then was that 26 degrees one night at 1 a.m. for 1 hour, and then the rest of the time it's been a lot warmer, or was 26 like you had it for like a week straight, or what?
Yeah, so here we got lucky. We got 26, I would say, maybe from 4 a.m. to 7 a.m.
So just one night, and then otherwise in the wintertime, what temperature is it normally in the evening here?
Normally, when it gets cold, I would say it would be like around freezing, 32. And like today, we're at 85 degrees.
Yeah, I'm sweating. Crazy. But how about last night?
Last night, I think was 60, maybe 65 degrees.
In overnight?
So when it's dark, I would say last night was really warm, probably 55, 65 degrees.
Wow, that's, yeah, nice to live in Florida, for sure. All right, next we got the kind that I'm growing at my house in Northern California, the Mexicola. So tell us about the Mexicola here in Florida.
All right, so Mexicola, very cold hardy as well. I would say probably 26, 28 degrees. It's also a compact variety. You see it's full of blooms right now. So we should have a lot of fruits. It's a small fruit, a green fruit, but it's also similar to the Hass. And yeah, that's one of the favorite varieties. They ripen in late summer.
And then on these ones, it's kind of like the smooth skin or skin like the Hass.
It's more like a thin skin.
Yeah, yep. The thin skin. I think you could eat the skin on this one. That's why I planted it.
yep.
When completely black, yes. Tastes like licorice.
There you go.
Actually, you could even sometimes eat the small little baby leaves, like the super small leaves. Kind of like the snack. I'm only on the Mexican type. I don't know the lineage of this, but I have, you know. Yeah, it tastes like licorice. Don't eat too many, though. And don't feed them to dogs. All right, next, we're standing next to the Brogdon avocado. So tell us about this one. Is this another small avocado like some of the other ones?
No, this is the largest of the varieties we grow. Brogdon, some people call it Brogdon with an A or O, with Brogdon with an O. Brogdon will make a large fruit, similar to like a Florida avocado that you sometimes see in the stores or usually see in the stores. So the fruits will be about that size. It's a black skin, kind of a thin skin with a large seed, but a lot of flesh, maybe four times as much flesh as the typical California Hass variety. And these, they are hardy, I would say down to about 26 degrees, 25 degrees. And the fruits ripen in the summer.
In the summer. And then how do the fruits taste? Are they're more buttery? Like, compare the butteriness of all the different varieties you have, like on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 being least buttery, 10 being most buttery.
I would say it's probably an 8.
Wow, that's pretty buttery.
Yeah, and really good for guacamole as well.
And now, does these trees get pretty big? I think this is a little bit bigger than some of the other ones we saw.
Right, so the size of our trees, the Brogdon can get pretty large, larger than the other varieties we looked at. However, what we do is every year in the summer, around June, July, we come with a ladder and we top all the trees. So these trees would be a lot larger if we didn't top them. We top them to keep them wider, fatter, but not tall. So it's easier to pick the fruits, and then you have more fruits because you get more light coming into the center of the tree, kind of like a peach tree. And also when we have hurricanes, it's better to have a shorter, chubbier tree, which has less exposure to the hurricane winds.
Wonderful. So because this is a large fruit, does it make less fruits on it than, say, you know, one of the smaller fruiting varieties? Because like tomatoes, obviously, cherry tomato puts on a lot of tomatoes, but maybe if it's a big tomato, like a beefsteak, it only has a few.
Right. Well, yeah, it may make a little bit less fruits than these other varieties we talked about. It will still produce a lot of fruits, but less than a Mexicola or a Joey for sure.
All right, the next avocado tree is a Wurz or a Little Cotto, and this tree to me doesn't look quite as, you know, large as some of the others. What's going on with this?
Yeah, so Wurz or Little Cotto is considered as a dwarf for many people. It still gets a good size, so it's a kind of a large dwarf, but the fruits are like a large Hass. Really, it's a thick skin, bumpy skin, and they ripen in the winter. So it's another good winter ripening fruit.
And to remind everybody, most avocados that are grown here in Florida are usually ripe when?
So we actually, when we did the class, we had a chart showing the calendar. We can have fruits all year round except for like April, May, June. So, but most avocado trees here ripen in the summer, late summer, fall. And then a couple of varieties will ripen in the winter.
Yeah, so actually I would personally recommend you guys buy them in the winter because those are more rare. A lot of people already have the avocados that, you know, will fruit in the summertime. So tell us more about the Wurz or Little Cotto. How cold tolerant is it? We know it is a dwarf and maybe kind of grows not quite as fat. This one's a bit taller.
Yeah, so it's not quite as hardy as these other varieties we looked at. And so, especially if you have a young tree, you want to protect it. I would say it's probably going to be hardy down to 26 degrees when it's mature.
Wow. So yeah, I mean, I would personally recommend you guys get one that is hardy or is cold tolerant, so you have the highest probability of success. Also have the other desirable traits that you want. All right, Luke, so this is a super Haas. So that means, does that mean it's better than the Haas avocado from California?
All right, so super Haas for us means that it does really well in Central Florida. The Haas avocado from California does not tend to do really well here. It likes more of a dry climate. Super Haas does really well in our humid climate. The fruits are just like a Haas, but almost twice as large. Super flavor, texture, very good oil content, and then it will ripen in the winter. It's not quite as cold hardy as the winter Mexican for sure, but it's a really good one for the Orlando area.
Wonderful. All right, so tell us about this next avocado, the fantastic. And to me, this tree looks really fantastic. It's actually growing out. It's nice and big, nice and lush and healthy, actually.
Yes, fantastic is our best, probably our best seller variety beside the winter Mexican and the Brogdon. The fruits are green, so they stay green when they're ripe, more like a bell shape, but that size. Very, very good flavor, texture again. They ripen in the summer, July, August, September. The trees are very vigorous, so this tree here is pretty tall. I need to cut it back down some more. Right now it's got, I don't know how many, more than 1,000 flowers, so we should have a lot of fruits from that tree. So the only thing for that tree is you want to make sure you keep trimming it if you have a small backyard, and don't let it go overboard or it'll get too large. So the cold tolerance of that tree is about 15, 18 degrees when it's mature.
So that's pretty cold tolerant compared to some of the others.
Yeah.
And it produces a lot and grows really well. So I think that's probably one of the better ones to get, huh?
Yes, for sure. Yeah, one of the better ones to get and to grow, again, all the way up to the Ocala, maybe South Gainesville. And in Georgia, if you have a protected area to babysit them when they are young.
All right, so the last avocado that we'll be sharing with you guys today is the Poncho. So tell us about the Poncho avocado.
All right, so Poncho, some people call it Poncho with an O. Super cold hardy as well, 15, 18 degrees when it's mature. It's a very compact variety, kind of like the Lila or the Mexicola. It's loaded with flowers right now. The fruits are like a small, kind of like the Fantastic, but more like a bell shape, about that size. And again, 15, 18 degrees, and ripens in the late summer.
Late summer, yeah. So that sounds good for maybe a late summer, but I want the winter time. So what I want to do for you guys next is actually we're going to ask Luke some questions about what's the best avocado for different conditions, and also share with you guys more about how avocados are pollinated to make sure you guys have the pollinators so that you too could be successful growing avocados as they are here. All right, so hopefully you guys didn't get confused with all the varieties. There are so many different kinds and you're probably scratching your head, I don't know what kind to buy, John.
Yeah.
So now we're gonna kind of narrow that down for you, you know? And here's the thing, every fruit tree is a bit different and it depends on what you want and your needs, you know? So we're gonna ask Luke here some common questions. So Luke, if somebody just wants the most fatty, most buttery ones, what's the top most buttery one, the second most top buttery, and the third most top buttery if the flavor and fat content is the most important?
So I would say the top would be the, let's put two. One that will ripen in the winter called Winter Mexican, and then one that ripens in the summer, the Brogdon. Uh-huh. These two varieties, usually people buy combos, and one of each, and they'll have fruits for more than 6 months of the year.
Perfect. All right, so then let's next go to what's the most productive, and like, I don't care what it tastes like because I just want a lot of fruit to eat that I grew in my yard.
Yep. So the most productive I would say would be the Fantastic. That will one tree about 10 years old will probably give you 200 to 300 fruits.
Wow. And then the second most productive,
the Winter Mexican.
Wow, Winter Mexican came up twice already in this.
Yeah.
Amazing. All right, so the next question is, what is the most cold tolerant? Because, you know, it gets pretty cold where I live. You know, if it's they want just the most cold tolerant. They don't care if it makes a ton or if it's good flavor. They just want it to make an avocado.
Yeah. So the most cold tolerant, the more bulletproof type would be the Fantastic.
Wow, the Fantastic also in this category, you know, in the top two, twice now. So wow, if you guys are listening to this, there's a few of these ones that you might want to pick up. All right, So Luke, the best one overall for summer growth that's gonna produce a lot, do well, and taste good. So just the best summer fruiting avocado.
So summer ripening avocado, I would say the Brogdon. And then again, the winter ripening avocado would be winter Mexican.
I see. All right, so we got summer and winter. So what's the best avocado if you don't have the best soil and you haven't amended it and all these kind of things? Like it's more tolerant of, you know, improper growing practices.
I would say again, the Fantastic.
The Fantastic. So that could handle more if like, you know, your yard and your dirt and soil is all messed up.
Yeah, yeah. One more advice is if you're not here in the sandy soil, a lot of people mound. So yeah. That instead of planting your tree on the flat where your soil is just your normal soil, you build it up with sand, some kind of material that will drain really well, like a 1 foot hill, a little mound, and then plant your tree in the mound. And make sure to not overwater your tree, especially in the winter. So you don't want to water too much. I would say maybe water once or twice a week as your tree is growing to prevent root rot, because root rot would be a big issue for avocados, just like mangoes as well.
Yeah, so the avocado's like a sandy soil for sure. So if somebody has clay soil, should they just say, I'm not gonna grow avocados because it's not gonna make it? What would you tell them how to make it so that an avocado could be a higher probability of success in a clay soil?
All right, so someone has a clay soil, then I would mound it up, bring a bunch of sand and do a 2 foot mound and plant it in that mound. Or something we didn't mention is you could grow those avocados in pots.
Yeah.
You could grow them in 3, 7, 15, 30. We have trees in 200 gallon pots and they could stay in those pots forever, be 18 feet tall and produce fruits for the rest of your life. Another advantage of growing avocados in pots is if you have it in a 30 gallon pot, 6 feet tall, 7 feet tall, and you've got a super cold night, you could slide it inside your garage for that one night and you will have tons of fruits and not have to worry about the cold and the clay soil.
Wonderful. So let's talk about pollination, because somebody just buys one tree and they call you a couple years later, the tree is great, it's 20 feet tall, but I've never gotten any avocados. What's going on?
Yeah, so the pollination is crucial. We didn't mention type E and type B avocados. Each variety is either type E, type A, or type B. Sometimes they could be both. And it's a little technical, but basically, if you have more than one variety and you try to mix the types, you will have better pollination. Also, just like any other fruit tree, we recommend to attract the pollinators. So try to have always some flowers in your garden. Plumbago, native flowering plants or non-native flowering plants, something to attract the pollinators. Here, we use the firebush in the spring, summer, and fall to attract the bees all year round and some other blooming plants. And also, something we didn't mention is on this property, we do not use any chemicals. So the key is to not damage your soil and not use any pesticides so that your soil will be healthier. And being healthier, you'll also protect the pollinators, the bees, the butterflies, and the wasp, and you'll get more fruits and they'll be healthier fruits.
All right, so is the avocado attacked by any pests? And what would you do if it does get attacked?
Right, so we've been lucky. I know there are several pests that can attack the avocados and several diseases. And the key is, again, to have some diversity. You know, if you have a grove of 1,000 avocado trees, I'm sure there'll be issues. There'll be things you have to deal with. Here, we never have to spray anything on those trees. I planted those trees about 7 years ago. I've never sprayed anything on those trees. I know there's a few diseases like the laurel wilt disease that could affect older avocado trees. We've not seen it here, and we've not had any customers in the last 10 years that have mentioned it. I think it's mostly attacking very old trees.
Wonderful, yeah, that probably are not that healthy. So let's talk about fertilizer needs and or building the soil up so that you can give the plant fertility without actually adding like a fertilizer, as people would think of fertilizer.
Right, right. So here, those old trees, when I planted them about 6, 7 years ago, I fed them for a couple of years with our organic fertilizer. And since then, I have not fed them at all. So none of the trees you looked at earlier have had any kind of fertilizer. But what we do recommend is that you put a lot of mulch, pine needles, mulch, oak leaves, any kind of tree leaves, to build that organic matter around your trees. That's why here we planted a lot of moringa trees when we planted the avocado trees, and once or twice a year we come and we cut them down, those moringa stems, and we shred the wood to create our own compost. So ideally you create your own on-site compost to provide your own source of mulch and compost.
Wonderful. Yeah, so build your soil organic matter. That's probably the most important thing here in Florida. I mean, I'm sitting here and it's like we're sitting on sand. This is, so you need to bring in a lot of organic matter, continue to build up your soil. So another question, Luke, since we learned about A and B type, so if somebody wants to buy the best A and B type together that will, of course, yield the most, be most productive and all these things, what are the two types that will cross-pollinate and also give you good fruit, good yields, easy to maintain and all these things?
Yep. So I would say if you want the two that will be a type A and a type B, I would say the Mexicola is a type B. A type A, and then the Brogdon will be a type B. Also, if there is confusion, we did that class last Saturday. We will post on our website the detail of all of our class, and each variety will have a page. So you're welcome to go to the website, probably later on this week, anaturalfarm.com, and you can see explanations of the type A, type B, which each variety is, and we'll have some other information on the grafting, for example.
Wonderful. All right, Luke, so my time is coming to the end. I think I actually got to head out pretty soon. But if somebody wants to order from you guys, and that's why I really love this nursery, because not only can you come here, but a lot of you guys are just watching this online that are maybe in Arizona or New Mexico, right? Some of those places, depending on how far north you are, even Houston, Texas, or even some places in Texas, Brownsville for sure. You know, you could grow these avocados just like they do here, and they will ship them to you. A lot of nurseries can't ship stuff out of the state. You know, they're certified so they can't do that. So how would somebody order from you?
All right, so we're open here Monday through Saturday from 9 to 5. But if you go to anaturalfarm.com, we ship to all the states pretty much through UPS. So you're welcome to order directly on the site. You could call us, email us, and you can definitely come here where we'll provide free advice as well.
Wonderful. And what's the phone number?
The phone number is 352-536-3112, 352-536-3112. It comes directly to me. This business is me and my wife, and we have some great employees that will take a picture with John later on. So everybody is pretty friendly and provide all the information.
Wonderful, wonderful. So any final words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers today about growing, you know, and growing food here in Florida specifically, because, you know, right inside out Orlando, because that's where we are and that's where you're growing lots of stuff.
Yeah, so first of all, I wanted to thank you, John, for coming here. Last time you were here was 5 years ago, and that boosted us big time. It helped us a lot. We're very appreciative of you. It was a great surprise to see you again today. That's great. It's just a wonderful place. What we like the most here is when people come with their children and they let them walk around in the food forest. They can taste all the leaves. They can eat stuff that they would never eat at home and enjoy it. And some of them, we have 12-year-old guys, little boys, they come here. They may start knowing more than I do. They are very passionate. So it's great to see the future of this environment.
Yeah, I mean, I hope more people come here as a little tour. It's a free tour. You don't have to, like, pay a lot of money like you need to go to Disney World. But you can come here and try some of the things that are in season and get a good education about growing food here in Orlando at the same time. So, yeah, thank you, Luke, for being here.
Thank you.
And I'm glad you're doing so well after the 5-year visit. And I hope you guys really enjoyed this episode, learning about avocados and that how you may be able to grow them wherever you live. And, you know, call up Luke. He could talk to you personally and he'll tell you, you know, straight up, he's an honest guy. That's what I really love about him. You know, they basically tell like it is. And like, he's like, oh, you want to grow an avocado in Maine? unless you got a greenhouse, save your money.
All right, thank you.
Double greenhouse, actually. You need a double. Or bring it in a pot inside your heated house in the wintertime.
Yes, sir.
So that's what I really love. And if you love this content too, hey, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up. And more importantly, share this with other people that want to learn about avocados and some of the best varieties you could grow. But not only could grow, but they'll get shipped to you so you could start growing them this season. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below, because you never know where I'm going to show up or when I'm going to show up, because I just dropped it on that today. And make sure you click the bell so you're notified as my videos come out. And finally, be sure to check out past episodes. I have over 1,700 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food. And I pop up all over the country and maybe hopefully soon the world to show you guys the best techniques and ways to grow organic food. And once again, link down below to the original video I made when Luke 5 years ago at this very farm, when he didn't have the barn and all these trees were a whole lot smaller.
Thank you.
So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.